Hi everyone, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're tuned into Our Library, which is a 30-minute programme sponsored by the lovely folk at the Masterton Library to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the library in the coming month or so. Our library is being broadcast to you today on Arrow 92.7 FM and your community access radio channel and Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. This programme is broadcast live on the third Friday of each month at 3:30 and repeated on the fourth Friday again at 3:30. So let's get started. So as I do every month, I do a selection of books, fiction, and followed by a selection of non-fiction. And it's purely just a random selection of books that are coming into the library, because there are hundreds, and I don't propose to go through them all today. So starting off, this is from the fiction side. The first book I've got here is called Death with a Double Edge by Anne Perry. Now, it's May 1911 when Daniel Pitt is summoned to a murder scene in the slums of London's East End. He fears the victim is his friend Tony Kitteridge, but relief is quickly followed by dismay when Daniel identifies the dead man as Jonah Drake, a distinguished senior barrister who has been killed with a double-edged sword. But what was Drake doing in Mile End? And does their head of chambers, Marcus Croft, know more than he is willing to admit? So with the police holding out little hope of finding Drake's killer, Daniel and Kitteridge rise to the occasion. Within days, they have leads that take them from the underbelly of the East End to the very highest echelons of society. Then Daniel's father, Thomas Pitt, receives a warning from Special Branch to cease the investigation. But Daniel and his father will not be deterred, despite the risks involved in the pursuit of justice. So now this is Death with a Double Edge by Anne Perry. Anne Perry was born Juliet Holm, and you may remember that name, in 1938. She's a prolific English author of historical detective fiction, best known for her Thomas Pitt and William Monk series. In 1954, at the age of 15, she was convicted in the murder of her friend's mother. She changed her name after serving a five-year sentence in New Zealand. If you remember the, remember the movie, Peter Jackson's 1994 movie called Heavenly Creatures? It's that's the lady, Juliet Holm, moved to England, moved back to England, changed her name to Anne Perry and became a very, very successful author, which I thought was just a little bit interesting. So that's Death with a Double Edge by Anne Perry. Next up, this is Fugitive by Paul Fraser Collard. And again, we're back in the past. Again, this is London, 1868. Jack has traded the battlefield for business, running a thriving club in the back streets of Whitechapel, in the East End of London. But this underworld has rules, and when Jack refuses to comply, he finds himself up against the East End's most formidable criminal, with devastating consequences. A wanted man, Jack turns to his friend McGregor, an ex-officer, treasure hunter, and his ticket out of England. Together they join the British Army on campaign across the tablelands of Abyssinia to the fortress of Magdala. A high-stakes mission to free British prisoners captured by the notorious Emperor... Yes. The Emperor Tuodros. But life on the run can turn dangerous, especially in a land ravaged by war. Now, this is the interesting bit. Paul Fraser Collard, who wrote this book called The Fugitive, was born in the UK in 1973. He's a writer of historical fiction, which shouldn't come as any great surprise, most notably the Jack Lark novels. But he actually works in the finance industry in London and lives in Kent with his wife and three children. So it's like he's an author, and quite a prolific author, and I would imagine successful, but his real career is working in the finance industry in London, which I thought was really interesting. There you go. So part-time author, and yet a very successful one. Fugitive by Paul Fraser Collard. Next up, I've got a book called The Garden of Forgotten Wishes. This is by Trisha Ashley, beg your pardon. Marnie's life isn't going to plan. Her marriage has ended and now she has to find a new home. On a whim, she chooses the beautiful village in rural West Lancashire she remembers from her mother's stories. Maybe there she'll find a place she finally belongs. Blessed with two green thumbs, Marnie takes a job as a gardener, mostly because the garden is dreamy, but also because it comes with somewhere to live. The garden might be in need of some TLC, but it is full of lavender and roses. It is also where she reconnects with Ned Grace. Due to a recent problem with an ex-girlfriend, Ned's heart is as bruised as Marnie's, but with a little time and summer sunshine, maybe love can blossom again. So that sounds like a really sort of sweet, romantic novel called The Garden of Forgotten Wishes by Trisha Ashley. Now, Trisha Ashley, she's from St. Helens in West Lancashire, and she writes romantic comedies. She believes that her typically dark Lancashire sense of humour in adversity, crossed with a good dose of Celtic creativity from her Welsh grandmother, has made her what she is today, whatever that is. Several of her novels are set in rural West Lancashire, West Yorkshire and Wales, and they frequently explore aspects of the three Fs that are a constant in her own life, that is, food, flowers and friendship. And the interesting bit is, to me anyway, is that each of her books includes a delicious recipe at the back. So I guess that's her thing, that's her little mark of difference. The recipe at the back. So that's The Garden of Forgotten Wishes by Trisha Ashley. Now, if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the Masterton Library, just to give you an idea of some of the books, the many books that are being introduced into the library in the coming months. So here's some more fiction. I've just done three fiction books. This is the fourth one that I've selected. And it's called The Harbinger. The Harbinger 2 by Jonathan Kahn. In this sequel to The Harbinger... In this sequel to The Harbinger, the reader witnesses the return of Nuriel, Anna Goren, and the mysterious figure known as The Prophet. When Nuriel, Anna Goren, and the Prophet return, they come with mysteries to be unlocked, one by one, through the giving of ancient seals. They also bring dreams, and a little girl as mysterious as the Prophet. Is an ancient mystery determining America's future? And what are the keys we need to have for the days that lie ahead? So this is a sort of fantasy type thing. Well, it's interesting because the author of The Harbinger 2, Jonathan Kahn, he's a messianic Jewish rabbi and pastor, best known for his best-selling novel, The Harbinger, in which he compares the United States and the September 11 attacks to ancient Israel and the destruction of the Kingdom of Israel. In particular, he sees Isaiah chapter 9, verse 10, as a prophetic warning to the United States. The Harbinger was followed with The Harbinger Companion with Study Guide. So that's a really interesting concept, I suppose, idea, putting his ideas across. The Harbinger 2 by Jonathan Kahn. Hush Hush by Stuart Woods. So this book is called Hush Hush by Stuart Woods. Stone Barrington is settling in for some downtime in New York City when an anonymous enemy makes himself known. This nameless foe's threats hit close to home, and before Stone can retaliate, the fearsome messages turn into very real consequences. With the help of old friends and a lovely new tech-savvy acquaintance, Stone sets out to unravel the fatal agenda. But as the web of adversaries expands, Stone realizes that no place is safe, and he'll have to flush out the mastermind before he and those closest to him are silenced for good. So that's Hush Hush by Stuart Woods. Stuart Woods is the author of 44 novels, including the New York Times best-selling Stone Barrington series and Holly Barker series. The last 28 of them have been New York Times bestsellers. He's an avid pilot, flying his own jet on 2 book tours a year. Interesting character. So that's Hush Hush by Stuart Woods, all sort of action type books he writes. I've never read any of Stuart Woods, but he sounds like it could be a fun read. Next up is, now this is really fascinating to me. This is called Stormbirds, and it's by, and excuse my mispronunciation, but it's by Einar Karason, translated from the Icelandic by Quentin Bates. So in February 1959, several Icelandic trawlers were caught in a storm off Newfoundland's Great Banks. What happened there is the inspiration for this novel. Not since The Perfect Storm has there been a book which captures the sheer drama and terror of a crisis at sea. Karason is an exceptional storyteller, an Icelandic Erskine Caldwell, or William Faulkner. The side trawler, Mefurin, is hit by a major storm just as they prepare to turn for home. 32 men aboard and a hold full of redfish. The sea is cold enough to kill a man in minutes. And the trawler quickly ices up in the biting frost and violent tempest. The heavy icing weighs down the already fully laden craft, which is pummeled by one breaker after another. And here, out on the open sea, there is no exit route. Distress signals from other ships in the same circumstances can be heard from the fishing grounds around them. It is a battle of life and death. So there we go. Exciting stuff. This is Einar Karason, born in Reykjavik in 1955. He's an Icelandic writer. He's been a full-time writer since 1978 and has published 16 novels. He started his career with poetry in literary magazines from 1978 to 1980, and in 1981 he published his first novel. He is best known for his novel, I've no idea why I wrote this because I can't read it. it's in Icelandic. I don't read Icelandic. Pasem Jofleyan Rees, which was translated into English as Devil's Island. So I'm going to put that on my list. That's Stormbirds by Einar Karason, from the Icelandic by Quentin Bates, translated by Quentin Bates. And I guess a lot of these novels are really dependent on the translation, but I understand this is a good translation. Stormbirds by Einar Karason. So if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston, and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the Masterton Library, to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the library in the coming months. Now, I just covered some of the new fiction that's available at the Masterton Library, and now there's a sample at random, completely at random, but some I thought would interest you, of the non-fiction. And the first one I've got here is, the title is William S. Burroughs and the Cult of Rock and Roll by Casey Ray. William S. Burroughs' fiction and essays are legendary, but his influence on music's counterculture has been less well documented until now. Examining how one of America's most controversial literary figures altered the destinies of many notable and varied musicians, William S. Burroughs and the Cult of Rock and Roll reveals the transformations in music history that can be traced to Burroughs. Burroughs, a heroin addict and a gay man, rose to notoriety outside the conventional literary world. His masterpiece, Naked Lunch, was based on the grounds of obscenity, but its non-linear structure was just as daring as its content. Casey Ray brings to life Burroughs' parallel rise to fame among daring musicians of the 60s, 70s and 80s, when it became a rite of passage to hang out with the author or to experiment with his cut-up techniques for producing revolutionary lyrics, as the Beatles and Radiohead did. Whether they tell of him exploring the occult with David Bowie, providing Lou Reed with gritty depictions of street life, or counselling Patti Smith about coping with fame, the stories of Burroughs' backstage impact will transform the way you see America's cultural revolution and the way you hear its music. So I thought it was a fascinating look into William Burroughs and his connection with various big names like the Beatles and Radiohead, Lou Reed. Now, the Casey Ray, who wrote this book, William S. Burroughs and the Cult of Rock and Roll, is an American born in 1974. He's a music business executive, musician and cultural critic, as well as a technology, music industry and media professor. So he knows his stuff. And I would imagine that's for those of you interested in Mutra and the music and the culture, with William S. Burroughs, I imagine you'd find that quite interesting. I think it would be quite a neat book to read. Next up is Life with Cars, New Zealand's Motoring Memories, 1950s to the 1980s, by Stephen Barnett. Life with Cars is like a national family photo album, albeit one with its focus on cars. It brims with evocative imagery of cars and automotive adventures from the 50s to the 80s, with the words of the contributors as told to the author. Their stories reflect New Zealand's creation and uptake of car culture, telling of breakdowns in the middle of nowhere, holidays at the beach, evading the law, Sunday drives, and of course, posing on, beside, or in the much-loved four-wheeled family members. Underpinning these stories are relationships, primarily between owners and their cars, but also between parents and children, partners in life, and young people and their peers, all during a time when cars had character. There was less congestion on the roads and petrol was cheap. Those of you of a certain age can probably remember those days. So that seems like a lot of fun. Stephen Barnett is a writer and editor. He spent many years working in book publishing and is the author and co-author of a number of books on social history and popular culture, among them New Zealand, New Zealand, In Praise of Kiwiana, At the Beach, and We Had One of Those. So there's an interesting look at a bit of Kiwi culture there. Life with Cars, New Zealanders' Motoring Memories, the 50s to the 80s, by Stephen Barnett. Now, there's a complete switcheroony. This is called Wake Up, and it's by Piers Morgan. You may remember the name. You may know the name Piers Morgan. In 2020, the world faced its biggest crisis in a generation, a global pandemic. In the UK, it exposed deep divisions within society and laid bare a toxic culture war that had been raging beneath the surface. From the outset, Piers Morgan urged the nation to come to its senses once and for all and held the government to often ferocious account over its handling of the crisis. COVID-19 shed shocking light on the problems that plague England. Stockpilers and lockdown cheats revealed their grotesque levels of self-interest, and the virtue-signalling woke brigade continued their furious assault on free speech, shutting down debate on important issues like gender, racism and feminism. Yet just as coronavirus exposed their flaws, English flaws, it also showcased their strengths. The British saw selfless bravery in the heroic efforts of their healthcare staff, a greater appreciation of migrant workers, a return of local community spirit, and inspiring noble acts from members of the public, such as Captain Sir Tom Moore. If you remember Captain Sir Tom Moore, lovely old gentleman that that marched round and round his property for charity and got hundreds of thousands of dollars. Just amazing, amazing character. I think he was knighted. Yes, he was knighted for it, wasn't he? Yes, he was knighted for it. Piers Stephan Puge Morgan, born in 1965, is an English broadcaster, journalist, writer and television personality, as you may well know. He is currently a co-presenter of the ITV breakfast programme Good Morning Britain from Monday to Wednesday each week. So that's Wake Up by Piers Morgan. Not one of my favourite people, but I think that would be an interesting book to read. Anyway. So that brings us to the end of the first segment of our library, during which I gave you a very brief overview of some fiction and non-fiction that are shortly being introduced or have recently been introduced into the Masterton Library. So at this point, I'll have a very brief music interlude. And when we come back, I'll talk about some of the books I've been reading and also about some of the wonderful programs that they run at the Masterton Library. Because the library is more than just books. There's a number of programs that they run, which I think you'll find interesting. So, at this point, I will put on, this is Elton John singing Durban Deep from his Sleeping With the Past album.
I believe in cold.
Hi there, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 30-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the Masterton Library to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the library in the coming month and some of the services that are on offer at the library. Now, this is the second part of the program. In the first part of the program, I went over some of the new fiction and non-fiction that's being introduced into the library in the coming months, or has already been introduced, to give you a head start and you can go ahead and order them. But it also gives you a flavour of just the breadth of books that are available at the library. Now, in this, the second section, I'd just like to go over some of the books that I've been reading, which you may find interesting. And I'll also go over some of the services available at the, some of the programs available at the library. So let's kick off then. So over the past month, I've managed to try to read six books. I've gone through six books this month. The first one was called The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime, and this is by Mark Haddon. It's a book written from an interesting angle, that of a mathematically gifted autistic 15-year-old boy who decides to investigate the death of a neighbor's dog. I must admit, I couldn't really get into it. I started it. I thought it was all a bit samey. It's very clever, written from the autistic child's point of view and his thoughts going into his mind, if you like, as he describes what's going on and conducts his investigation into this dead dog. But, no, I kicked it into touch after a little while. So it was okay, but I didn't think it worth finishing. There's so many good books to read. So I'm sorry if you've read it and loved it. I didn't. It wasn't my thing. Next one I had in my list to read was Daylight by David Baldacci. Now, I find David Baldacci always fun to read. I've read I've read 33 of his novels, according to my list. Lots of action. He's always been a big page turner for me. He puts a number of characters into his novels, which I do find a bit confusing. I have to keep on going back and trying to work out who they are. But it always seems to come together in the end. He has a number of different series that he does, each focusing on specific characters. But recently he's taken to combining those characters, and he has like joint series. And this is Daylight by David Baldacci. This is featuring FBI agent Atlee Pine and former Army Ranger John Puller teaming up together to solve a case. Now, each one of those has got their own series. So now they're together working on this particular case. And I hate to say it, but I sort of after 33 novels, I think I may be over David Baldacci now. I found Daylight very confusing and a bit drawn out. I was sort of waiting for it to finish. And there's just too many characters for me to keep in my head at one time. As I say, I found the ending a bit confusing at all as well. So to me, Daylight by David Baldacci was a bit of a dud. No, that's harsh. That's harsh. It was okay. It was okay. It is David Baldacci, after all. Very, very popular writer. Next up, my love of Irish writers. I do love the Irish writers. And this is The Sea by John Banville. Now, The Sea is his 2005 Booker Prize-winning novel. So I thought, if you're going to start somewhere with a new author, I've not read any of his stuff before, let's start with his Booker Prize-winning novel. And no, I'm sorry, I just didn't care for this one at all. I managed two pages, but I really found it a boring stream of consciousness. And no, I dropped it very quickly. As I say, I love Irish writers, but not this one. So I'm not doing very well at the moment. So that's The Sea by John Banville, which I didn't care for. Now this one is Room by Emma Donoghue. This is the fourth book I tried to read this month on recommendation from a friend. I loved the last Emma Donoghue I read. I can't remember the name of it now. But I really enjoyed her last novel, but I just couldn't get into this one at all. It's written from a child's perspective. A very, very dark novel. And I was warned about that when my friend recommended it. But again, I just couldn't get into it. It just didn't resonate, as they say. So there was another one that bit the dust. That was Room by Emma Donoghue. And I'm sorry if you loved it. A lot of people love that book. Not me. We've all got different tastes. You've got to appreciate that. The next one I read was Dark Tides. And this was by Philip Gregory. And I've read a lot of her stuff and enjoyed a lot of her work. This is second in the Fairmile series. It's set in 1670, just after Charles II has been restored to the throne of England. The novel traces the lives of one family across London, America, and Venice. So it combines elements of three very different cultures and where they all were at that time. Interesting. I found some of it very interesting, the different cultures, especially in America. Oh, and Venice was interesting too. But messy. I found it messy. It was okay. It was all right. And the last one I tried was All My Secrets, All My Mother's Secrets by Beezy Marsh, set in the old slum laundry houses of London in 1918. A very simple style of writing, I thought. Almost childish, very, very simple. But there again, I think it was supposed to be reflective of the times. And they were simple people, and it's written from their perspective as well. So again, I'm afraid it didn't resonate, and I didn't finish it. So there's six books that I didn't do very well at, but that's life. Sometimes you get good ones, sometimes you don't. And I've just started Shari LaPena's latest thriller, The End of Her, and I've read most of, if not all, of Shari LaPena's other works. She wrote The Couple Next Door, A Stranger on the House, In the House, On the House, etc. And enjoyed them all. And I'm enjoying this one. It's from a woman's point of view as well, I guess. And it's all about revenge, and there are some very strange women in her books. Nasty, nasty women. And murders and intrigue and, yeah, blackmail and all that good stuff. And it's a real page-turner. I think it's a page-turner. Well, to me it is. I'm really enjoying it. So that's Shari LaPena's latest thriller, The End of Her. I can recommend that, although I haven't finished it yet, but it's very good. All right, so that's the books I've been reading and what I'm trying to read now. In fact, I've just been to the library half an hour ago, and I've got two books for my audience with the on Wairarapa TV. This is called Hamnet. And this is by Maggie O'Farrell, based on the son of, well, there's one of the twin sons of, or twin children. He had a boy and a girl that were twins. Hamnet was one of them, and Hamnet dies at age 11. And the novel is based around that family. Shakespeare is off writing plays and stuff, and this is centered around the family coping with the tragedy. Especially Shakespeare's wife, coping with the tragedy of losing a child. So I'm looking forward to reading that. And it comes highly recommended. Very, very popular in the library. I forget how many people are on the list, but there's a lot of people who have got it reserved. And this one is A Promised Land by Barack Obama. And it's very popular. It's very big. So that's going to be interesting. It's about his first year in the White House. 700 pages. We'll see how that one goes. So that's the next two books that I'm planning to read this month. So we'll see how that goes. Next up are the programs available at the Masterton Library. Now, the thing with the Masterton Library is that it's not just books. There are DVDs, CDs, magazines, paintings, jigsaws. I think there are toys and things that you can rent out. But they also have a number of programs that they put together for children and adults. And some of them, I think some of them be really good. Some of the children's programs, and there's a timetable. You can go to the library and pick up the timetable of the programs. It's just a two-page timetable, one giving you the programs and the other with a calendar showing when those programs are on that you can pin up on your wall and circle and things. Some of the adult programs, or the children and teen programs, there's one which is Baby Story Time. Explore the world of books and enjoy the magic of stories and activities in their preschool story time. Feel free to bring a morning snack. Tea and coffee provided, that's always good. Every Wednesday during school term. Babies. So that'd be nice for young mothers or mothers with babies and can take their babies along and do a baby story time. Story Go Round is another program exploring the world of books and enjoy the magic of stories and activities in their preschool story time. Feel free to bring a morning snack, tea and coffee provided, every Wednesday during school term. So that's the Story Go Round. I guess it's in the same style as Baby Story Time, but this is for preschool age and not quite, a little bit more than babies. There's a Tureo program, and I won't abuse the language, I can't pronounce it. But anyway, it's a Tureo program delivered in Tureo, but is open to all. Introduce your child to Tureo with stories, music, and crafts every Thursday during school term. Preschool age. A little bit interesting. There's another program called Lego Play. Drop in any time and have fun building and creating with Lego. And that's every Thursday. You don't have to remember this. Just go to the library, pick up the program. It's got all the programs in there with the calendar showing when they're on. There's Mission Minecraft. There's a Minecraft interactive way for kids to build online worlds together. There's a family story time. Bring your children of all ages to the library for a family story time. Now, this one's interesting. This is sensory story time. It's an inclusive story time aimed towards children with sensory needs, such as autism spectrum disorder, ASD, sensory integration challenges, or short attention spans, ADSD, and so on. If you're interested, please contact Charlotte to schedule a time for sensory story time. So contact the library on that one. If you've got an autistic child you think might benefit from that program, it could be quite good. There's a Harry Potter book night. Come along for the annual Harry Potter book night. Lots of fun, crafts, snacks, games, and prizes. So that could be quite good. And they've also got adult programs, you'll be pleased to hear. They've got a Justice of the Peace, so if you need a JP for anything, to witness signatures and so on. They've got one there, no registration required. Sustainability workshops, sourdough and spirits. Join them every month for a workshop on sustainability. So that could be quite good if you're into that sort of thing. Sit, knit and yarn. It's an opportunity for crafty people to sit and share their ideas and skills and assist each other. Members knit for donation. That sounds like a really interesting thing if you're crafty, into the crafts and so on. Good thing to do. There's the Masterton Scrabble Club. Everyone from beginners to enthusiasts. The new club will be part of the New Zealand Association of Scrabble Players, giving you access to their great resources and expertise. Gold coin Koha appreciated. Contact the library for that one. Wairarapa Women's Cross Stitch. Vision, sorry. Wairarapa Women's Cross Stitch vision is to meet with people with the same interest and passion for stitching to share and support each other to complete projects. To learn more about cross stitch, from starting the project to completion, every Thursday during school term. Contact the library on that one. That sounds good if you're into cross stitch. Another program they've got called The Gathering. Join neighbours, friends and family in a friendly and safe place where you can talk, share and make the space your own. We imagine this to be a space of shared yarns about family, careers, music, tattoos, crafts, games, chess, jigsaws, blah, blah, blah. So you can see they've got a huge range of programs for children and adults. Take full advantage of that. It's all, most of it's free. I think there's koha. Quite often there's tea and coffee provided. Bring your children along for babies. I mean, there's everything there, really. Digital programs, they have device advice, where you can drop in with your technology questions. If you're maybe a little bit handicapped with your lack of digital knowledge, you can pop in there and get some advice. Digital Seniors Masterton Hub. And there's a drop in there, free coaching for seniors on how to use mobile phones, tablets, iPads, etc. So it's all there. All the programs they've got are just incredible for the, and it's a big community thing. It's great for the community. And while you're there, you can get out a book or two, or a DVD, or a CD, or whatever. Everything is there for you. Which is really good. Now, I say, one of the things I'd just briefly like to talk about is, for those of you who read a lot, I found some time ago that walking around libraries and just browsing, while it's fun, it was quite often unproductive. And the way I now get books is I do a lot of reading of online reviews, and Amazon or Goodreads, you get them in the listener reviews, all sorts of things. I belong to a Facebook group where we share the books that we're reading, give our opinions on books and so on. There's all sorts of ways you can find out new books that are coming in. And having found a book, I then just go onto the library's website and I'll reserve it. And I've got a list there. I think I've got about 22 books that I've reserved. And having done that, you have to be careful because you don't want to get too many books and all of a sudden get a dozen books to read all at once. So, but you can manage the list as well. You can set the dates when you want to read them. Set a date, say, don't alert me right now, but I want this book, and you can set a date like a month or two in the future. And I do that quite often. So as soon as they become available, they don't necessarily come straight to me, but they check the date first, and then once that date's gone past that date, then I will be alerted that that book is available. And that's the other thing, you get notification when the book is available for you to go and pick up. So I've got a list of 20 right now, 22 books that I'm interested in reading, and it will alert me when those books are ready to be picked up. And I can take them in there and go in there and just pick them up. Which is handy for me. I live in Greytown, so I've got quite a trip, well, 25 k's, but I don't want to be doing that every day. So I can time my visits to the library, which is very handy. So it's particularly useful if you're maintaining a large list of items, which I do. I make good use of the library, and being from outside the area, course, I am. It's a free service to Masterton people who live in Masterton. So if I live outside the area, and I pay a fee to do that, I pay a fee to belong to the library. And I'm very happy to do that. because it's a wonderful library system, and I use it a lot. So I think that's all I've got today. So I've been through some of the non-fiction. I've been through some of the fiction books that are available coming into the library. I've gone through some of the programs, lots and lots of programs that they have at the library for you, for everybody. So please, pop along to your library, enjoy them, read books, that's all good. And I think that's about me for this month. So I'm Steve Lillyston, that was our library. That was a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the Masterton Library to let you know about some of the new books and programs that are available at the library for you to make use of. Thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoy the show. Please tune in again next to hear our next broadcast of our library, which will be on Friday, February the 19th at 3:30 p.m. on Arrow 92.7 FM, your community access radio channel, and broadcast on Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. So until then, happy reading. Bye-bye.